Good afternoon, or actually, good morning, field biology. By the time you watch this, it will be in the morning. This is our first video lesson on the mammals, the identification of the various North American mammals that we're going to learn about. And on your FOCAB Google form, I had you ask or answer a few terms, one of them being mammals. So what is a mammal? A mammal is a got a few characteristics, such as being warm-blooded, giving birth to live young, breathing air, having fur or hair. But a lot of people miss the meaning of the word mammals. And if you've heard of mammary glands, you know that that is a way that the mother can feed the baby or the offspring through nursing and through milk. And it's the name of those mammary glands that actually gives the name to these animals mammals. So a lot of people are tend to forget that. So pretty important. Our first grouping is the carnivores. And I think almost every single person was aware of the meaning of that word. It means meat eater. If you are a Spanish-speaking person or you've taken a Spanish class, you may remember that carne is Spanish for meat. So just another connection there for you. Carnivores are going to have ways to get at their meat-type food sources. A lot of that is evident in the teeth. And when we get to skulls, you'll realize and see a lot of that. So maybe can't see it in the pictures because they don't all have their mouths open like this lion here. Okay. Remember, we're on North American mammals and North American carnivores. So some of your answers that I've seen, some guesses at, like hyena, cheetah, some of those aren't entirely correct because they don't live in North America. All right, so here's number one, the Arctic fox. Okay. The Arctic fox lives in the northern part of North America. As you can see, ice and the tundra are its habitat. One clue for animals, just a future clue here. Animals that live in cold environments like the Arctic tend to have smaller extremities, such as ears. Okay. And the whole idea there is less surface area, less likely that can get frostbit or be exposed to the extreme cold and freeze or get frostbite. And so when we see animals that are in very cold environments, we tend to see small extremities like ears. Slide two, also an Arctic fox. So from this slide, notice the background and the leafy vegetation, we can tell that Arctic foxes change color. Okay, they change color seasonally. They turn white in the winter to blend in, and they turn sort of a mottled brown or silver or gray in the summertime. Yes, there is a summertime up in the north country. So it may not be like our summer, but it is summer. Notice the short ears once again. Number three is the red fox. This is the fox that you're probably the most familiar with in our region, named for its red coat. Other clues for the red fox is the white chin and chest and belly. White tail tip, which this picture doesn't have a great angle on that, but do have a white tail tip. You'll actually see it in a future picture. And black legs. Okay, black legs, and sometimes even some black in the ears, especially on the back of the ears. That's the red fox. And if you've been lucky enough to see one of those, awesome. They're making a comeback. They were succumbed to a disease called mange back in the 80s and the 90s. Number four. Believe it or not, this is also a red fox. Technically, this is called the silver phase of the red fox. And what we get here is we still have the white tail tip. we still have the black legs and the black ears. It's just we're lacking the red or the orangish pigment in the fur. Instead, it's almost like a frosted, each hair is almost frosted with a silver, black towards the bottom, towards the root. And so they give that the silver phase name. There's also a red fox called a cross phase. Now, initially, when you see the cross phase fox, you might say, well, yeah, it's kind of a cross between the red fox and the silver fox. And looks fairly true. However, that's not where the name comes from. It does work. The name actually comes from the old fur trade, where when fur trappers would sell their pelts, if you can imagine this animal skinned and the pelt laid flat, you'll notice from the nose straight down the head and the straight down the middle of the back to the tail, it's darker. You'll also notice some darkening across the shoulder area on both sides. So when that skin is laid out flat, it makes the shape of a cross. And so that's where the name cross phase or cross fox actually comes from. And the red fox is not a color-changing animal. So these phases are lifelong. In fact, most of the animals on this slideshow do not change color. We have maybe three or four that do. Okay, the Arctic fox being one. So the red foxes, typically born this way, the majority of them look like number three. But once in a while, you'll get one that looks like number four. Okay, if it gets the correct genetics, gene combination, inherits it from their parents. Or they could, once in a while, you'll have them look like this too. It's just not as common. Number six, this is called the kit fox. I've heard some other names thrown out there before. We're going to go with the kit fox. One of the problems with common names is different regions might have different names for the same creature. Here we see a larger ear. So that would indicate living in a hotter climate. So animals that live in a hotter climate, such as this kit fox, like the desert, they have big ears radiate or release heat from their body. So it's a way for them to stay cool. It doesn't shade them, but it actually allows for some evaporation of heat. Remember, we don't, or other animals don't sweat like we do as humans. We have a unique way of sweating, and we do really well in hotter climates, but some of these animals with thick coats don't. They don't do as well when it's really hot. Number seven, this is the gray fox. The gray fox may look very similar to a few of the phases of the red fox, but from a distance, or if you squint your eyes a little bit, you'll see a little more of a gray coloration here. There is some rust and red colors, but we have more of a gray throughout, non-white tail tip. So the tail is uniform in color and doesn't end with a lighter color. And these are the smallest foxes in our region, I guess. Minnesota and Wisconsin have a pretty healthy population of gray fox. They're more of a forest creature. So we're right on the edge. Once in a while, you'll hear of someone seeing a gray fox in the Red River Valley. But they actually have the ability to climb trees like a cat. So foxes are weird. They're considered dogs, but they're not in the same genus as most dogs. They actually fall into a different category. So they have a few cat-like behaviors, which makes them pretty interesting. Number eight, the coyote or coyote. You are going to watch a video or a short video and an article showing the difference between coyotes and wolves because they're pretty commonly misidentified, I guess. So let's actually do this. Let's look at the coyote. Then let's look at the gray wolf. Okay, and you'll notice a couple of features right off the bat that set them apart. Fullness is kind of the name of the game here. So looking at like a more slender face and nose, we have the coyote. Okay, even more pointy in the ears. Kind of a gray, Coyotes can vary, but for the most part, they're gray with a little bit of tawny, which is kind of a light tan in the ears, here in the flanks. White, typically a white chin, chest, and neck area. They can vary a little bit. Sometimes they look a little red and stuff. Wolves, by comparison, much wider in the nose and the muzzle, the jaws, the ears even are a little bit wider and more rounded, and just a larger animal altogether. So if you look at the size of a coyote, is like a medium dog, where a wolf would be bigger than most large dogs. This is the gray wolf. And so is this. So this is also the gray wolf, and they're very much like the red fox example, where they have different color phases. So because they're called the gray wolf, most of them are gray. However, once in a while, you'll get one that gets the correct gene combination or hereditary info, and you can get a black phase gray wolf. So still is a gray wolf. It's just darker looking. And we can also get a white phase gray wolf. So that's number 11 for you. Notice this is not albinism or being an albino. An albino is lack of all pigments. And so we would also be lacking in the nose. We'd see more of a pinkish nose and maybe even a pinkish or reddish eye color because of the lack of pigment there. So that's one way to distinguish it from being an albino. Number 12 is the red wolf, and you'll see this one, the hair is a little trimmer, a little shorter, ears look a little bit bigger proportionally, yet we have some snow. These are actually desert wolves. They can live at some of the high elevations. We think of states like Arizona and New Mexico as being these hot states, but they also do have mountain ranges. And they can have snow and they can have some cold weather. So that's where these would be from. That was the end of our dogs. Okay, wild dogs anyway. Now we're going to move on to the cats. So the wild cats of North America. Number 13 was the bobcat. And it is named because, no, it's not. His name is not Robert. The actual reason they call him a bobcat is because of his tail. A very short tail. So if you ever, they say it's bobbed or, looks like it's cut off, looks like it's short. I think females have a hairstyle called the bob, which is a short hairstyle. So that's why it's called a bobcat. Really a cool looking animal, I think. Very beautiful pelts, a lot of spots in there, short ear tufts. Pretty good size though, quite bigger than your normal house cat. And very similar to the bobcat, the lynx. So if you look back and forth at these, we can see a few differences. Lynx tend to be a larger animal. And we'll see some major differences when we get to skulls. I'll show you some other diagrams and stuff. But right now we're getting pretty basic, just the name and a couple features. Larger ear tufts, sort of a mustache type. Beard, I don't know what you would call that, handlebar mustache or something maybe. And they lack spots. They're a little more uniform in color, but they can have some spots. Okay, but the lynx is a bigger cat. It's also more of a northern North American cat. Southern states, we can see a lot of bobcats, but if you want to find a lynx, you're pretty much going to have to go to, Canada or north to have a good chance of seeing a lynx. Number 15. This cat actually, from what I've heard, lives from the top of North America all the way down to the tip of South America. And because of its wide range, it has about 80 some common names. Okay. So I want you to know three common names: the cougar, the puma, and the mountain lion. Okay. I want you to know all three of those. I think most people in North Dakota call him a mountain lion, which is, I find interesting because we don't even have mountains anyway. But next would probably be cougar. Other names I've heard him called, panther, catamount. There's quite a few. Like I said, there's 80 some. Of course, some of those are probably language or dialects or slang from different parts of North and South America. But really a seclusive, large, this is pretty much the top predator in most of North America, for sure in North Dakota. And yes, we do have some mountain lions roaming. 16 is the jaguar. Okay. I get a lot of kids that want to say leopard on this one. The difference is they're very similar in terms of appearance and behavior and niche way of life. But the leopard lives in Africa. So the jaguar lives in North America, primarily Central America and some of the, you know, southern parts of North America. If you're a football fan, remember the Jacksonville Jaguars? That'll help you, you know, throw out the whole idea of using the word leopard. So I would use that. 17, at least from what I know, watching my daughter play Minecraft, I think there's ocelots in there, I believe. So if you're a Minecraft player, you may have come across the word ocelot. Another wild cat of the southern states. Really interesting looking cat with its spots. Looks very house cat-like. I think people even have kept them as pets at times. And another smaller cat that lives in the southern states, the jaguarundi, which kind of deceiving because of the lack of spots. To me, it looks like a really short mountain lion or small mountain lion. But the correct name is the jaguarundi. So take jaguar and throw U-N-D on it, and then throw I at the end, and you got the spelling of it. All right. That is our dogs and cats. So that gets you through about one half of the carnivores. Stay tuned for the next half of the carnivore video, and then we'll do some reviewing in class. So if there's other info you want to talk about with these guys, we can do that, or any questions you want to ask, we can sure do that. All right, thanks for watching.